to us physically here, where would you want to be? Where would you want your family to be? And then you'll turn around and ask you questions. But Jesus is here.
Amen.
He is here.
Amen.
Is he not?
Amen.
He is here.
Amen.
The glory of the Lord is in this place.
Amen.
His power in the house.
Amen.
His presence is so evident. You can't deny it. I'm talking to you. You can be sitting right in the back there. Pastor, do you feel the presence of the Lord in the house?
Amen.
There's a glory in this place right now. And I tell you what, you can't deny it.
Amen.
It's undeniable.
Amen.
Power of God. And if God be for us, who or what can be against us? Amen. Morning, and I want you to be a participant in this preaching. Would you be a participant in this preaching with me this morning? Amen.
Amen.
You want me to preach this morning?
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. I'm telling you, something's about to give in this house.
Woo!
I feel the glory in the place right now. I sense the same kind of anointing when the children of Israel came out of Egypt and they looked behind them. 600 chariots of Egypt coming up behind them. They looked to the side and there were mountains on either side, and they looked out in front of them and there was the Red Sea, and they knew, man, we're gonna die. We can't go forward, we can't go backward, we can't go sideways, because every side there's an obstacle. I don't know if there's somebody in this house feels like everything is caving down on them. Every side you look, some kind of a obstacle. You get over this one and there's something there, and you get over that one and there's something there. Man, I know there's a glory, because when they came out of Egypt, there was a cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. Hallelujah. The Bible says that when they came before the Red Sea and the armies of Egypt were behind them, that the glory from in front of them went behind them and stood between the armies of Egypt and the children of Israel. And the Bible says that the Holy Ghost harassed them. He nuggered them. He caused them to step their toes. He put his foot in the axle and broke the axle. He capsized their horses. Hallelujah. I feel a militant spirit right here, right now, and I feel some chariots of Egypt is about to capsize. But greater is he. I said, greater is he. You don't get it. I said, greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. Come on. No matter what is happening in the world,
Now this morning I'm going to do a sermonette on the glory of the new covenant. The glory of the new covenant. And firstly, church, let's just, you know, it's such a deep subject when you talk about covenant. It's so big, so huge to cover in a 30-minute sermon. However, just some pointers to know, and some of you might already be aware of the stuff that's recorded in the Bible. Firstly, when we talk about covenant, we talk about a legal binding agreement in the heavens.
Amen.
Amen? Now, I'm going to come back to the legal binding and the agreement part. But the covenant, when we talk about the old covenant, we talk about the old laws, the Old Testament, the former way of sacrifice for the remission or the forgiveness of sins. Amen? Now, Pastor's been teaching us about the tabernacle and the three different sections and, you know, the ladder and all of those things in that tabernacle. And it was the old order of worship. It was the old order of sacrifice where you could not go boldly before the Ark of the Covenant. Everybody with me? You remember that? You had to have a priest going on your behalf to make atonement. And that priest himself was not perfect like the priest in the New Covenant, Jesus Christ. That priest had to first evaluate himself, make atonement for himself, look at his shortcomings, his failures, make atonement for himself, and then for the community and the family. Amen? So, there are many distinctions, there's quite a lot. So, I'm not going to go Old Covenant, New Covenant, but I want to set some things in place. The Old Covenant was established upon many, almost 613 legalistic laws. There were ceremonial laws, there were moral laws, there were value laws, all of these different laws that came into place in the Old Covenant. And man was always falling short of achievement. We could never, no matter how hard we tried, I mean, if you look at the journey of the Israelites through the Exodus, God repeatedly told them, if you would just not do that, he made a covenant, they broke it. He made an agreement, they broke it. He told them, I took you out of Egypt. You know, all the diseases that came upon the Egyptians, not one of the Israelites had a disease. The Bible says they left Egypt healed. There was about 3 million people at the time. God healed 3 million people in 1 minute.
Amen.
Come on. In one very second as they left Egypt, the entire Israelite generation was healed. And they went into the wilderness for 40 years. Their garments did not perish.
Amen.
Their sandals did not wear down. Come on, somebody.
Amen.
Their feet did not swell. And you research what swells the feet. There's the dog here. Almost so many diseases today, from pregnancy to high blood pressure to sugar, diabetes, everything affects the feet from swelling. So for 40 years, he healed them at one instance and kept them properly healed for that journey. Hallelujah. That's the beauty of our God. But all through this, Israel, God's people, kept on failing, kept on messing up. So God said, okay, Moses, build this tabernacle and let the people now bring sacrifices for atonement. Now, the Bible says that without the shedding of blood, there can be no forgiveness of sins. Amen. I'm putting you in the picture before I really start. So, blood had to be spilled for the forgiveness. Now, in the New Testament, and we'll really cover this, the Bible says that if sacrifice continued, that means true forgiveness was not yet attained. If sacrifice continued, true forgiveness was not yet attained. In other words, the Old Covenant gave you a temporal forgiveness. And it didn't even forget the sin, because the Bible says that it could not erase the conscience of the sinner. So you have to come with a guilt offering, a retribution offering. That means if you stole something, you've got to pay it back according to the temple shekel, to the right value. If you rob somebody of their cows, or their goats, or whatever you did wrong, you've got to pay back. Now in the New Covenant, the Bible says that Jesus was the sacrifice once and for all.